This is another day that the Lord has made, and we're going to rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Today is May the 10th of the year of our Lord and Savior Jesus, 2020. Amen. And we're celebrating this Sunday morning worship service. Amen. Emanating from the sanctuary of the Second Baptist Church, all the way from Roselle, New Jersey. Amen. We'd like to take this opportunity to wish all of the mothers a happy and blessed Mother's Day. Amen. Happy Mother's Day to one and all in the name of Jesus. From Second Baptist Church to you, to God be the glory for the great things that He has done. Faith of Our Mothers, hymn number 193. Thank you, Lord Jesus. There we go.
Faith of Our Mothers living still in cradle song and bedtime prayer, in their sweet low and fireside love, Thy presence still pervades the air. Faith of our mothers living faith, we will be true to Thee till death. Faith of our mothers loving faith, bound up our child to trust and grace. Oh, may Thy consecration prove source of a fine from the nobler race. Faith of our mothers loving faith, we will be true to Thee till death. Faith of our mothers guiding faith, for youthful love and youthful doubt.
In Jesus' name, we do pray. Amen. Amen and amen.
Amen.
And we're going to sing the song, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Hymn number 27, amen. The songwriter says, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of the Spirit, washed in His blood. Hymn number 27, Blessed Assurance. Amen. Here we go.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine.
Heir of salvation,
purchase of God.
My story,
this is my song.
What is my song? from the Old Testament in the 27th chapter of Genesis. Genesis chapter 27, and we're going to read verses 1 down to verse number 30. And the Word of God declares in Genesis chapter 27, beginning at verse number 1, and it came to pass that when Isaac was old, and his eyes were dim, so that he could not see, he called Esau, his eldest son, and said unto him, My son? And he said unto him, Behold, here am I. And he said, Behold, now I am old. I know not the day of my death. Now therefore take, I pray thee, thy weapons, thy quiver, and thy bow, and go out to the field, and take me some venison, and make me savory meat, such as I love, and bring it to me, that I may eat, that my soul may bless thee before I die. And Rebekah heard when Isaac spake to Esau his son. And Esau went to the field to hunt for venison and to bring it. And Rebekah spake unto Jacob her son, saying, Behold, I heard thy father speak unto Esau thy brother, saying, Bring me venison, and make me savory meat, that I may eat and bless thee before the Lord before my death. Now therefore, my son, obey my voice according to that which I command thee. Go now to the flock, and fetch me from thence 2 good kids of the goats, and I will make them savory meat for thy father, such as he loveth. Thou shalt bring it to thy father, that he may eat, and that he may bless thee before his death. And Jacob said to Rebekah his mother, Behold, Esau my brother is a hairy man, and I am a smooth man. My father peradventure will feel me, and I shall seem to him as a deceiver, and I shall bring a curse upon me, and not a blessing. And his mother said unto him, Upon me be thy curse, my son. Only obey my voice, and go fetch me them. Verse 14. And he went and fetched and brought them to his mother. And his mother made savory meat, such as his father loved. And Rebekah took goodly raiment of her eldest son Esau, which were with her in the house, and put them upon Jacob, her younger son. And she put the skins of the kids of the goats upon his hands, and upon the smooth of his neck. And she gave the savory meat and the bread which she had prepared into the hands of her son Jacob. And he came unto his father and said, My father. And he said, Here am I. Who art thou, my son? And Jacob said unto his father, I am Esau, thy firstborn. I have done according as thou badest me. Arise, I pray thee, sit and eat of my venison, that thy soul may bless me. And Isaac said unto his son, How is it that thou hast found it so quickly, my son? And he said, Because the Lord thy God brought it to me. And Isaac said unto Jacob, Come near, I pray thee, that I may feel thee, my son, whether thou be my very son Esau or not. And Jacob went near unto Isaac, his father, and he felt him and said, The voice is Jacob's voice, but the hands are the hands of Esau. And he discerned him not, because his hands were hairy as his brother Esau's hands. So he blessed him. And he said, Art thou my very son Esau? And he said, I am. And he said, Bring it near to me, and I will eat of my son's venison, that my soul may bless thee. And he brought it near to him, and he did eat. And he brought him wine, and he drank. And his father Isaac said unto him, Come near now and kiss me, my son. And he came near and kissed him. And he smelled the smell of his raiment and blessed him and said, See, the smell of my son is as the smell of the field which the Lord has blessed. Therefore, God give thee of the dew of heaven and the fatness of the earth and plenty of corn and wine. Let people serve thee, and nations bow down to thee. Be Lord over thy brethren, and let thy mother's sons bow down to thee. And cursed be everyone that curses thee, and blessed be he that blesseth thee. And it came to pass, as soon as Isaac had made an end of blessing Jacob, and Jacob was yet scarce born out from the presence of Isaac his father, that Esau his brother came in from his hunting. May the Lord God add a rich blessing to the reading and hearing of his most holy word. Please be seated in the presence of the Lord. There's a song that's entitled, God Will Take Care of You, amen? And we know that in these last and evil days, we need the Lord like never before. Hymn number 220 in our hymn books, God Will Take Care of You. If you ever needed the Lord before, we sure do need him now. Is that right? Amen. So hymn number 220, God Will Take Care of You. It's a promise. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Hymn 220. Praise God, our sound booth technician, Brother Kendrick Abraham. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. For our chairman of the Deacon Ministry, Deacon Joe Williams. Praise God. Hallelujah. I see Deacon Darrell Jackson. Amen. I see Sister Anita. Amen. There's not 10 of us in the building. Not 10. Amen. Amen. Just a few. Hallelujah. But we represent you, and you. Amen. Praise the Lord. To God be the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a special prayer request. We want to remember Sister Lynn Page and Brothers Clifford and Maurice Page in the passing of their father and grandfather, Brother Charles Chapman. Amen. Amen. Also, we want to remember Reverend Teresa Francois and family and the loss of her brother-in-law in Jesus' name. Also, recent and upcoming birthdays. Amen. Last week, there was a technical difficulty on my part, not on the church clerk's part. Amen. But I was not able to announce the birthdays last week, but we're going to combine them last week's and this week.
Amen. Amen.
And so recent and upcoming birthdays, on Monday, April the 27th, Brother Antonio Bellauti. Amen. Amen. Saturday, May 2nd, Master Young Abraham Smith, 14 years old. Sunday, May the 3rd, Sister Cheryl Middleton Mitchell. That's Dr. Cheryl Middleton Mitchell. Saturday, May the 9th, Sister Gabriella George. Monday, May the 11th, Deacon John Relack, Brother Naftali Carney, and Sister Connie Kennedy. Wednesday, May 13th, Sister Karen Nazaire. They all have and have had a blessed birthday. Amen. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. And then May the 9th. Amen. That's Minister Darren Williams. Amen. Praise the Lord. Recent and upcoming anniversaries. Wednesday, April the 29th, was Brother Julian and Sister Renee Smith. 20 years. Sunday, May the 3rd, which happened to be a birthday and a wedding celebration, amen. Brother Leonard and Sister Cheryl Mitchell, 17 years. Isn't that wonderful that you can get married on your birthday? Hallelujah. Amen. Dual celebration. Hallelujah. Happy birthday. Happy anniversary. And then also Wednesday, May the 7th, Brother Peter and Sister Rosalind Bartholomew, 14 years. And also, congratulations are in order for Mrs. Marlon Brad and family, and also for Pastor Mike and Reverend Moret Tyree and family on the birth of their great-granddaughter, Aaliyah Jordan Bernardo. That's the Marlon Brad and family. Amen. The great-granddaughter. And then also daughter Mia Elena Tyree, amen, born by Pastor Mike Tyree and Reverend Moret Tyree, amen, both born on the same day, Thursday, May the 7th.
Amen.
We pray that all will have a blessed day.
Amen. Amen.
Now we thank God for all of our gifts and thank God for all of our offerings that have been received and are being received by one and all. We're going to bless them in just a few moments. But there are three ways, there are ways that we can give, amen, to remain faithful in our giving. Option one is to mail indirectly to the church, to Second Baptist Church, P.O. Box 304, Roselle, New Jersey. Second Baptist Church, P.O. Box 304, Roselle, New Jersey, 07203. Or you can give your donation, your offering to the diaconate ministry, to your diaconate member, that's assigned to you. Amen. Also, the second option is to drop off your offering every Sunday morning during the time of the corona shutdown. Amen. Drop off your offering here at the Church of Second Baptist, 200 Locust Street. Amen. From 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. And then the third option is electronically through text to give features from the APLOS web, APLOS web. And so, here's how you do it. You simply text GIVE and whatever the amount is, and then you text that to the telephone number 833-561-0179. That's 833-561-0179. 561-0179, and then you write down in the memo section, give in dollar sign or whatever that amount is, amen, and then you forward your gift, and the prompts will set up your account, amen. And so we're asking the Lord's blessing, Father, that you will bless, oh God, the gifts and the offerings that have been received and are being received to the glory of God. We pray now, Lord, that you bless every giver, that you'll open the windows of heaven, that you'll pour out blessings upon them, that they won't have room enough to receive. And you said, Lord God, hallelujah, God, that you would shower your richest blessings upon them, Father God, for giving faithfully to you, and that, Lord God, you would bless us in such a way, Lord God, that with that room not to to be received, oh God, you would do it abundantly. Lord, and thank you for it. We ask that you bless those that didn't have the ability to give, but they had the desire to give. And we pray, Lord God, that you'll touch those that are unemployed, those that are in a state of desperation right now for receiving funds because of the national lockdown, the state lockdowns. So we pray in Jesus' name, Lord God, that you will provide, especially for those that do not have, and for those whose funds are being blocked. We ask, Lord God, that you release them, even now, in the mighty name of Jesus, that especially your children and those that are your children to be, and those that even are not, will be provided for, in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, we glorify you, and magnify your name. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
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 Now please note, all future services will be available via streaming or by way of our conference call until further notice. And so the three ways to be connected, one is through Facebook Live. That's SBC Roselle, SBC for Second Baptist Church, SBC Roselle at 10 a.m. on Sundays. And then Instagram Live, again, SBC Roselle at 10 a.m. on Sundays. And then also the third option is through our conference call. Dial in at 978-990-5000, access code 374-329-POUND. That's Sundays at 10 a.m. and Tuesdays at 10:30 a.m. and 7 p.m. for your Bible study. The same phone number, 978-990-5000. And then for replay or playback, you can still call 978-990-5099, access code 374-329-POUND. Again, for playback from any of our services or Bible studies, 978-990-5099, the same access code, 374-329-POUND. And then church family, if you're unable, pardon me, to attend church services in person, or please stay connected through the diaconate and ministry leaders, and please contact Deacon Joseph Williams at 908-245-4717 or Reverend Burley Jones, 973-704-1040, should you need anything. To God be the glory. Amen. Well, we give God the glory and praise. It is now preaching time, and we want to share God's word. Amen. In just a few moments. Amen. As we sing this song, I found the answer. I've learned to pray. I'm Generally, we as human beings are selfish by nature. We generally don't like to make sacrifices because that means that we have to do without so that someone else could have. We have to give and they would become benefited and enriched, and then we would become poorer by what we have given. We now end up lacking what we had so that others might have. That's typical of what is a sacrifice. And so the Word of God lets us know that obedience, though, is greater or better than sacrifice.
Amen.
And when you consider that, it's like, how can obedience, which is a non-tangible, supersede and excel a physical sacrifice, which is tangible? But that's how God looks at things. Mm-hmm. His ways, his thoughts, aren't like our thoughts and ways.
Yeah.
What God considers at a premium and premier, and what God considers good and great and high, those are the things that he considers that in man's eyes are trivial, insignificant, and sometimes impossible. But we thank God, and I thank God, that God is God.
Amen.
And he knows what he's doing.
Amen.
When we were children, we thought that our parents were out of date. We thought that our parents didn't have a life. We thought that our parents didn't have a clue, that they were old-fashioned. They were phonies and buddy-duddies, as people would now. I haven't used those terms in a long time. Amen. And sometimes we just couldn't understand their quirkish ways, especially if our fathers would say, well, son, this is going to hurt me more than it hurts you.
Amen.
And we turn around and say, well, Dad, then let me spank you. That was the last time we said that. Amen. But our parents chastened us, they chastised and corrected us, not to abuse us, but because they loved us and wanted to make sure that we had a good quality of life. And they wanted to make sure that we wouldn't be hurt in the future by misbehaving, by acting out of character, or by instigating or agitating or aggravating someone to the point that they would want to take our lives because of the way that we talked, the way that we shared in our body language. They wanted to make sure that we were safe, that we were respectable, that we were outstanding and upright citizens in our community, in our family first, but in our community, in our churches, in our world, so that others might be blessed and benefit as a result of the sacrifices that we made. And so we see in today's text, amen, there's a sacrifice made in the scripture whereby the mother of Jacob, amen, we find that there were two sons, Jacob and Esau, and the mother Rebekah, the mother of Jacob and Esau, made a sacrifice in that she knew that she was about to deceive her husband to get a blessing for her son, and she was going to pay for it. She was going to pay for it through her husband. And then she was going to pay for it through even understanding that she's going to have to pay for it by God. But in essence, she was saying within herself, I know that what I'm about to do is wrong, but there's a son of mine. I have two. They're twins, Jacob and Esau. But I see a future in Jacob that Esau does not have, whereby Jacob can go before certain individuals and make a difference. And he has an influence whereby he can effectuate a greater benefit to the masses of people than my son Esau. And so therefore, I know that I'm guilty before God. And so I'm going to just ask God to just lay all of that guilt upon me, because I'm going to tell my son to lie, to not tell the truth. But I'm going to take it upon me. Hold it not to my son's charge. I know it's a curse, but curse me. Now that's a sacrifice. When you're saying to yourself, curse me, lay not these sins and lay not this charge to my son or anyone else, but put it on me. Put the blame on me. I will assume full responsibility. But I've got to do something now, because there is a benefit that has to take place for people in the future and for the children of Israel. And so we find in the Word of God where Rebekah spake to her son Jacob, and she says, behold, I heard your father speak to Esau, thy brother, saying, bring me venison and make me savory meat that I may eat and bless thee before the Lord, before my death. I heard your father say that. Now, therefore, my son, obey my voice. This is what Rebekah said to her son Jacob. Obey my voice according to that which I command thee. Go now to the flock, fetch me from thence two good kids and of the goats, and I will make them savory meat for thy father, such as he loveth. Now, their father, amen, Isaac, loved venison. Venison is deer meat. The thing is, deer meat is gamey, though. It's oily. And so here Esau goes out, and he's a skilled hunter, and he's going out to find his venison for his father so that he can bring it back, his mother can prepare it, and then now he can present it before his father can eat the venison, the bread, eat that, and then bless Esau. So while he's on his way, even though Rebekah, the mother, heard Isaac say that to Esau and send him out, she told Jacob, Jacob, come here. Your father wants choice venison, and your brother just went out to go hunt for it. But I want you to go get two goats, and I want you to bring them here. And I'm going to prepare them. I'm going to doctor them up and make them taste like deer meat. See, because goat meat is also oily and gamey. And so therefore, if you don't know the difference in how it's been savored, You'll never know the difference. It's the same to you. So he gets two goats, and then she also takes the goat hairs, and she places them on the hands and the back of the neck of Jacob, because Jacob is a smooth-skinned individual. And Esau is hairy. Now, he's got to be pretty hairy if his skin is like goat skin. Like, you know, has anybody ever rubbed the fur or the skin of a goat? That's kind of rough. So we're talking about twins, which is a stark difference between smooth and hairy. I guess she must have thought when she had Esau that he was Frankenstein. I probably scared her. I said, oh, look at the hairy boy. Praise God. Amen. But here, Jacob gets this meat. She prepares it. And he goes before his father. But he asks the question. And he said, but my father, peradventure, Mom, he's going to feel me. And I shall seem to him as a deceiver. And I shall bring a curse upon me and not a blessing. He was concerned about that. But here's the sacrifice of the mother. His mother said unto him, upon me be thy curse, my son. Only obey my voice and go fetch me then. So he did. And so he brings it back. His mother prepares it. He goes before his father, and his father blesses him. Now, a sacrifice is made in the present with the expectation of a future benefit. That's what a sacrifice is all about. Sometimes we sacrifice spending certain monies that we have so that we can invest towards the future. So we'll put the monies in a savings bank or savings account, a savings plan. There are people that sacrifice spending all of their paycheck, and they put a little aside for the Christmas club. They put a little aside for the birthday club. They put a little aside, they sacrifice for someone's college tuition, one of their children's or their children's college tuition for the future. There are sacrifices that we're making. Sometimes you want to buy certain things for yourself and go out and dine yourself, and pay $50 to $100 or more dollars for a nice dinner. But then you say, no, I think I'm going to save that money so that I can buy food for the family, or so that I can have something for futuristic benefit or need for my family. It's a sacrifice. So there are times that we just have to do without. That's a sacrifice so that someone else might benefit in the future. And it very well could be yourself. And so the word of God in Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verse 1 says, cast thy bread upon the waters, for thou shalt find it after many days. Now, people would say, put your bread on the water? Well, what a waste. You know, it's going to get soggy. It's going to sink down to the bottom, and I can't eat it now. And maybe the fish are going to get it. Or maybe those creatures down below in the water are going to get it. What benefit could casting my bread possibly do for me? Well, that's God's way of thinking. Cast your bread upon the water. Now, he's likening it to real bread, but he's actually telling you, make an investment. Make a sacrifice in the present with the expectation of a future benefit. So do without certain things so that other things can happen and transpire so that others might be blessed in the future. So I'm going to have to sacrifice playing football and hide and seek and playing baseball or basketball with my friends. I have to sacrifice playing with them outside by doing my homework, by studying. And you know, when we were children, we loved playing outside. Now, that's for old school. Mm-hmm. You know, for going outside, that was a reward. Staying inside was punishment. Nowadays, I can't understand it, but staying inside is a reward and going outside is punishment. We say, go outside, no, you hate me. You hate me, you want me to go out, and you want to go outside. You don't like me. They get all upset. When, for us, in old school, parents and say, no, you got to finish your homework. You say, I can't come out because I got to do my homework. But it's the sacrifice of not playing to do your homework that you might excel, that you might gain some knowledge and wisdom and understanding that for a future benefit, you'll graduate from school.
Amen.
But for a future benefit, you can possibly go to a vocational school, a trade school, or go to college, and now you can advance your educational pursuits and then achieve certain goals and dreams and aspirations that you could not have otherwise accomplished because you have now sacrificed the pleasures of sin for a season, the pleasures of your physical desires, so that a futuristic benefit might be experienced. So the word of God says, cast thy bread upon the waters, for thou shalt find it after many days. This is the place where we have to trust God in casting our bread upon the water. This is the place where we have to trust God, to trust that God's work will agree with God's word. For we're standing on the promises of God. And so that's where our mothers have exercised faith in God. Where, when it seemed like it was an exercise of futility, that there were impossible situations and circumstances to be achieved or accomplished, but they read in God's word to trust in the Lord with all of your heart, lean not into your own understanding, and acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. And so the faith of our mothers was so strong and so sound that they took God at his word.
Amen.
And so they trusted God's, that God's work would agree with God's word, whether they saw it or not.
Yeah.
Because the just shall live and walk by faith and not by sight. And so oftentimes our mommies and our daddies, but today being Mother's Day, our mommies would exercise a type of faith that it seemed, well, mommy, you're dreaming, you're fantasizing, this is not going to come to pass. But we did not know the faith that was in them, in their hearts, and their souls, and the connection and the relationship that they had with God.
Right.
We're looking through the eyes of the flesh, and they were looking through the eyes of the Spirit.
Amen.
Their eyes were on the prize and the prize giver, amen. So amidst all of our anxieties, cares, and fears, and doubts, they were believing God whether they saw it or not. We have to take God at his word.
Yeah.
As his word declares, be not weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Sometimes our parents did some things that we thought, well, mom, why are you telling me to take some food over to the neighbor's house when we just have a little bit and you're going to give our food to them? And we just never understood they were casting the bread, our bread, upon the waters and giving it to the neighbors. And it's like, but mom, that's not right and that's not fair. What are we going to have to eat? And sometimes your friends would come by and there's just enough food for your family, but your friends come by and now mommy takes the food and starts taking something that might possibly go on your plate and put it on their plate. And we're looking like, mom, do you really mean to take this food from us and give to them? Mommy knew what she was doing. She was blessing those that didn't have, and understanding that it was more blessed to give than it was to receive. Why? Because when you cast your bread upon the water, amen, praise the Lord. It's like the word of God says that when you do good for people, amen, God will bless you, amen, and he'll bless you in such a way, he said, give. And it shall be given, and men shall give unto your bosom. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over.
Amen.
When we didn't really have it all to give, but we gave anyway. Amen. And so God says, and men are going to give back to you, back to your bosom, directly to you, in a way, in a measure that is like pressed down, You ever take potpourri, I think I'm pronouncing that properly, and it comes like in like little rocky type of shapes, and you put it in a jar and you fill it up, but it's hollow. It's a lot of hollows. But when you press it down and you crush the potpourri, now in a jar that's this tall that was filled, and then when you press it down, now it's granulated form, about this much in the jar, which means you can put more hollow potpourri in there, and you keep crushing that and crushing that and crushing that. Now you have a jar full of crushed, granulated, or powdered potpourri, amen, which now is about maybe 100 times more than what you would have had if you left it in the hollow form, amen. Press down, and then when you shake it together, amen, so that there's not another possible void, another air pocket, amen, that those granules can occupy. Press down, shake them together, and then to the point that put some more in there so that it just runs over, so that others can be blessed. Amen. Give, amen, and men shall give unto your bosom. Press down, shaken together, and running over. And that was the faith, and is the faith that our mothers embraced, amen, that we might be blessed of God.
Amen.
And when you're blessed of God, hallelujah, you can't lose, rather, amen, for the stuff that God uses.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And so there were mothers that made selfless sacrifices. I didn't say selfish sacrifices, but selfless sacrifices. They thought of themselves less. So Rebecca, the mother of Jacob and Esau, Genesis chapter 27 and 28. Rebecca made that sacrifice, and she said, curse me. Everything that's supposed to happen to you as a result of me telling you what to do, I told you to do wrong, but let me be cursed. I'll bear it all if I miss out. Apostle Paul even said this, I will that I would be a castaway so that my people, the Hebrew people, would be saved. I would wish that upon myself. Now, he didn't actually do it. He said, I would. but he's hoping that the Hebrew people would accept the Lord Jesus Christ to come to understand that he is the Hebrew children's Messiah. And so he would say, I would, in exchange for you being saved, becoming saved, I would be rather willing to be a castaway. I would rather myself become an outcast or even cast into hell. If that's what it would take for all of you to be saved, I would wish a curse on myself so that you might be blessed.
Amen.
What kind of sacrifice is that?
Amen. Amen.
And then Jochebed, J-O-C-H-E-B-E-D. That was the mother of Moses in the book of Exodus. When the Egyptian Pharaoh decreed that all Hebrew baby boys were to be thrown and drowned into the Nile River because the Pharaoh feared that they might become too powerful, but Moses' mother, Jochebed, hid Moses for 3 months. But when she couldn't hide Moses any longer, she waterproofed a basket, put Moses in it, and she placed and released the basket with Moses into the flow of the Nile River. She, by faith, was casting, literally casting her bread upon the water. But we find that Moses' daughter happened to be walking by the riverside.
Amen.
Amen. Pharaoh's daughter happened to be walking by the riverside, and she saw this ark, this little basket that Moses' mother had put him in, and she asked one of her maidservants, get that basket, and she opened the basket, and as soon as she did, the baby Moses cried, and Pharaoh's daughter's heart of compassion went out towards this child, and that child became hers. But then, here's how God worked it out. Moses' sister, Miriam, was there, and she says, oh, that happens to be one of the Hebrew children. Would you like me to find one of the Hebrew women to nurse this child? And Pharaoh's daughter said, oh, good idea, I'm paraphrasing. So she goes back home in haste and says, mother, guess what? You're going to be able to nurse your son that was birthed to you, that was put in the basket. Girl, don't play with me.
No, Mom, for real. I ain't lying.
That's what we would say. Even color people.
Mom, for real. And so now Moses' mother gets a chance to nurse and educate the faith of the Hebrew children, of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to Moses until she weaned him, until he became a great man, amen, in Egypt land. But she made sacrifices. Then Mary, the mother of Jesus, she made sacrifice. Amen. She sacrificed herself to be this holy virgin woman. Amen. When other people could have played the field and there were other people trying to court her, date her, but she wanted to remain a virtuous woman, a virgin woman, so that maybe, perchance, the Lord might honor her, that she might be the one, the maid, that would bear the Christ child. And as a result of her sacrifice, here the Lord sent the angel Gabriel and said that you are highly favored, amen, with God. And that he was going to place the Christ child in her, and so she was highly favored. To God be the glory, amen. Among women, she was the most highly favored. To God be the glory that she would bear the Christ child. But then to come to find out that all of the sacrifices that she made for Jesus, all of the persecution, even having to flee the place where he was born because of the king Herod being so furious to now kill all of these Hebrew children, we find that Mary made sacrifices for Jesus, amen, to do without so that he would have. And now we find that Jesus gets to the point of making the ultimate sacrifice of dying for our sins. He's on the cross, and she stands there in the very close proximity of Jesus being crucified, knowing that she could be killed for being labeled as one of his disciples, but nevertheless she stood there and hazarded and jeopardized her own life and safety so that she might watch her son Jesus Christ die.
Amen.
On the cross. But the Lord, amen, for the futuristic benefit, saw her standing at the crucifixion site, and he said, "Woman, behold thy son," talking about John, the beloved disciple. There was still going to be a futuristic benefit for the sacrifices that she made for even that present time. Amen. And then he said to John, "John, behold your mother." John, the beloved disciple, took Mary home, amen, to provide for her. So we give God the glory and the praise, amen, for our mothers, amen, and for the sacrifices that they made. But I'd like to play a little song for you, praise God. Amen, in commemoration of Mother's Day. Amen, to thank God, amen, for the sacrifices that have been made. And this is a song by Shirley Caesar. And she sings this song simply, amen, which goes like this. Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.